very important work that allows us to organize this seminar here today. The World Health Organization Global Health Histories Project was born about 10 years ago, and it consisted, among other activities, in a series of seminars that have been growing the past few years. Between then and now, over 95 seminars have taken place, mainly in Geneva, but also in Copenhagen, Cairo, and Colombo in Sri Lanka. And today, events is the first to be held in the Americas. Fiocruz and members of the Casa Osvaldo Cruz have a long connection with these events. One of them was Human Moment, that was for some years an officer at the World Health Organization and coordinator of the WHO Press and of the Global Health Histories Project for over 10 years. The World Health Organization Global Health History Seminars have a truly worldwide reach, from a series of events that concentrated on linking academics from around the world with officers working in the WHO headquarters in Geneva or other regional offices. It flowered into a global activity through an important innovation in 2009. The live broadcast of events over the internet, allowing free online participation. As in the past few years, today's event followed this important practice. This seminar is being broadcast live, and we welcome all online attendees to ask questions freely and be part of our debates. The World Health Organization Global Health History Seminars reach has now extended to a very large degree, and a number of regional offices, like the office in Europe, located in Copenhagen, is participating in this project, especially thanks to an association with the University of York and our friend Sanjoy, and also supported by the Wellcome Trust. During the past few months and maybe a couple of years, there have been conversations between the Pan American Health Organization and Fiocruz to have something similar for the Americas. And I'm glad to announce, I just learned, thanks to Sanjoy, that WHO has agreed to have these seminars here at Fiocruz that will represent an encounter between history and health policy for the Americas. Before presenting the speakers, I just want to make a small historical comment. A few weeks ago, I was in the archives of the League of Health Organizations in Geneva, and I found the papers of the International Center of Leprosy that existed in Rio de Janeiro during the 1930s. There have been already a number of studies on this center, a master's dissertation and a doctoral thesis of a student of Gilberto Hochman, but I was really amazed about the effort of Carlos Chagas, a scientist, as all you know, very attached to this organization, for negotiating with other stars of medical science at a time and public health to have the center located in Rio de Janeiro. And he was able to do it, and also to gain the support of the Brazilian government and local philanthropies, and to create a real center of excellence that made original research, published the Brazilian Journal of Leprosy, and was really another example that not all science in the so-called periphery is peripheral to the international network of knowledge. No? So today we have three very distinguished speakers. In the first place, Eusenir Sarno. She's a pathologist, a professor of pathology, a researcher at Fiocruz from the 1990s, has a number of remarkable publications in national and international journals like the British Journal of Dermatology, and the Leprosy Review, the Journal of Infectious Diseases, the Journal of Tropical Medicine, one of the most distinguished Brazilian researchers in this field. And the title of her presentation is Learning from History to Better Understand Leprosy.
Good morning for all. And I'd like to thank the organizers. I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to participate in the meeting. I first going to mention some turning points, historical turning points in leprosy that I understand is we are making significant changes in the understanding of the disease. And then I'm going to comment some content of the poster book. As a turning point, I chose some of them, very few. In 1873, Mycobacterium leprae was discovered, was the first pathogen discovered by Gerhard Amauer Hansen, a Norwegian doctor. But it took 70 years to have the first treatment, the sulfones. That treated thousands of patients, but most of them have to take for life. In 1960, important contribution by research came up. The shepherd mouse footpad model and the armadillo model of M. leprae infection. Both make possible research in leprosy. In this decade, still in this decade, started to emerge some comments, some reports about the sulfonyl resistance. In 1976, sulfonyl resistance was confirmed. And the WHO, together with TDR, the recently created branch for research of WHO, created two steering committees for leprosy. One for new treatment research, the other one for developing diagnostic tests and the vaccine. At the same time, BCG vaccine for protection against leprosy was started to be evaluated in more than one center. It takes more than 10 years to be proved that at least in some population BCG confer protection. In that time, in the end of the 70s, 5 million cases worldwide was reported. In 1982, WHO came with the multi-drug therapy, the combination of the three drugs, potent drugs, rifampicin, clofazimine, and dapsone. Free of charge for all leprosy patients in the world. And then leprosy became a curable disease. In 1990, TDR also participated in the genome consortium to sequence the M. leprae genome that also take 10 years to succeed. In Brazil, I just selected some facts that I witnessed. This started in 1985, when a democratic government installed in Brazil after 20 years of dictatorship. It was estimated in that time 300,000 cases of leprosy. The Minister of Health making profound changes with new control strategies, creating a leprosy national coordination, revision of the files, and creating a national database for case registration, organization of the services, training many, many thousands of professionals, and created the Technical Advisory Committee to write the new guidelines. And it created and indicated some leprosy reference centers, including Fiocruz. All these measures, all these activities, active support from ex-patients movement Mohan. In 1991, the 24 doses of immediately for multiple celiary patients was adopted as recommended by WHO. Plies, contact surveillance, and the BCG vaccination. In 1995, the Minister of Health, attending the demand of the Society of the Nephrologists and the ex-patient, changed officially the name of leprosy to Hanseniasis. In 1998, following the WHO recommendation, the treatment for multiple celiary patients became to be 12 doses up to now. In 2011, leprosy, this is the recent history, 2011 leprosy was included among the neglected disease national program. And I'm sure that Dr. Castalha will talk about the rest of the history, of recent history. Here, just to show you what happened in Brazil, with a drastic decrease of the prevalence, that this is in red, until 2006, then became a plateau. But unfortunately, the number of the rate of detection cases remained stable for many, many years, but finally, and fortunately, started to decrease, slowly decreasing. Here at Fiocruz, we tried to make our collaboration, our contribution to the leprosy control for this almost 30 years. And this started when I assumed the leadership of the Leprosy Research Center here at Fiocruz. During these years, 3,300 patients were treated in our outpatient unit, and double of them was diagnosed here. And 9,000 contacts were examined. This is the largest cohort of the country. And among this contact, 60% were vaccinated, 44% were children. And very important, 80% of contact examined were diagnosed of leprosy. 8%. From this result, I understand that contact surveillance is essential for early diagnosis. But when I started to think about this chapter, the first question came to my mind was, why is leprosy still endemic in our country? And I go to history. to try to understand it. And I asked two colleagues to help me in this quest. Maurício Lisboa and Jimena Daramendi. That are both interested in history and the ethical issues. Among all the documents, you have many documents you have to read. The collection of the Oswaldo Cruz, Casa de Oswaldo Cruz, the book written, the documents of the Casa de Oswaldo Cruz, and also the books written by Dr. Souza Araújo was very, very, very useful. But two theses give me the intriguing ideas. One was the evolution of Hanseníase in Brazil and the perspectives for elimination for public health problem, written by Vera Andrade. And the other one was the from leprosaria and the preventive home to Hanseníase has cure. Remnant from a past that continued to exist. Written by Roseli Maciel, this thesis was presented at the Institute of the Economy of the UFRJ. I'm not going to tell you everything I learned during this journey. Even I didn't put in the chapter. I'm just going to point out some highlights. Lepers arrived in Brazil with colonizers and increased with African slavery. At that time, lepers was endemic in some African countries and also in the Iberian Peninsula, 16th century. In 16th, 17th century, there are reports of numerous cases to the crown warring the population, mainly in large settlements. In the century, in the 18th century, 19th century, many hospitals were built to shelter the patients and sometimes the family, all family of disease. And the isolation measures began. Here one of these hospitals in the north of the country. But only in the early 20th century, with the revolution led by Oswaldo Cruz, and colleagues such as Carlos Chagas and later Souza Araújo, with the evolution of public health. These professionals, these leaders, designated the leprosy as a public health threat. And then prophylactic measures were taken, based on the Berlin Congress held in the end of the 19th century that recommended leprosy colonies, recommended isolation measures. Leprosy colonies were built, many in Brazil, almost in all the states, supported by federal government, with strict isolation measures. In 1940, sulfone introduced in Brazil as was introduced for all the world. In compulsory notification. In that time, when sulfone was introduced, the isolation measures started to be a little bit relaxed. And the ambulatory treatment was sometimes permitted for all pulmonary patients. but compulsory notification of new cases was determined by the Ministry of Health. But in 1960s, it started to arose some controversy over the efficiency of the isolation policy. Comes from the nephrologists, from the movement of the ex-patients. And in 1986, during the new government, leprosaria were declared unconstitutional. Here one photo of the small Lazar house, this had we the call, and in the Amazon region. You see all the patients with families, small children. And here, the president Getúlio Vargas inaugurating a colony in Santa Catarina. It was really initially a very strong support of the federal government. And in this photo, you can see a preventive home where the small children were taken from the sick parents and raised far from them. Here they have one of the largest colony in São Paulo, Bauru, that was very well administered and was inaugurated in 1935 and until the 1986, when the colony was abolished and it became a national reference center for leprosy up to today. And with the name Instituto de Lauro de Souza Lima. And take in mind all these comments, this learning, and I understand that if you want to understand why is leprosy still endemic in our country, we have to go more deeply into unofficial historical facts that unfortunately are very little accessible. So I'd like to make some thanks, Dr. Umemome, for the kind invitation to participate in the post book. And the editors, in name of them, Alexander Medkev Kauf and Dr. Sanjoy Bhattacharya, who helped a lot. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Senir, for the presentation. And our next speaker is a privilege to have her here with us, probably very well known by most of you. She was a director of the Pan American Health Organizations and developed a series of programs not only on neglected diseases, but also on primary health care. She's from Argentina, Cordoba. Now, she's among the many appointments that she has as special envoy of the Global Health Network Knowledge. And something interesting that is that I learned yesterday is that one of her first works was in Leprosarium in Cordoba, Argentina. No? So she has a long history also working on and studying leprosy and neglected diseases. So it's an honor to have Mirta Rosales.
Thank you so much, and also to the organizers and my friends here at Fiocruz and Sanjoy for the invitation. I think that when I was invited and also asked for the focus of the presentation, I thought about having the I thought about having some reflections about what can we learn from leprosy for other challenges that we have in public health, and following some of the ideas presented by Eugenie in the situation of Fiocruz, and also reviewing the history. Because leprosy is a kind of model that we can look at and learn every day if we want to make a difference in the outcome, health outcomes on many of the diseases. This is also the 97th seminar on leprosy history, so there has been a lot of different contributions in the last years since the global health seminars were established. And it also reflects some of the most faithful supporters of going back to the leprosy, the history of leprosy, like the Sasakawa and the Nippon Foundation and Wellcome Trust and so. So I will take from the seminar in 2009 some of the key reflections of the two presenters at that time, Warbois and Nordin, the former chief of the leprosy program at global level in WHO. And one of the, I think that is still very relevant to remember, that some of the possible factors for this constant coverage and neglect of diseases like leprosy and others that we have in the family of neglected, that we pull together under the title of neglected tropical diseases, are one thing is the first of all, maybe no threats to trade and social order. So as you have seen with many other problems that are around today with some of the diseases, this is the major concern of the public and the powers who take decisions. So if they don't pose a threat to trade or social order, then you don't prioritize and you don't pay much attention to these things. The other is that they are not endemic, they don't generate outbreaks. As Rosa will say later also, even for the patient, for years and years, it may not be something very difficult to go on with. And it affects mainly poor people, and in most of the cases also in very concrete areas or territories. There's a low perception of risk, therefore, for those who take decisions. It is very recent, as Eugenie has shown, that we have moved from a missionary approach to the care of leprosy to recognize it as a state obligation. And on top of that, we have a very complex epidemiology that I will go very briefly on those things. There are very small numbers of cases that are bacteriologically positive. Even in the highest burden countries, this disease is around 3% prevalence. There's a very low attack rate to those closest contacts, particularly household contacts. So it takes a long time also of exposure, and it's not very successful. Most of the processes move on to become self-healing or very mild. And now we know, also after the genome project that Eugenie mentioned, that we have really four different strains, very much related to different regions of the world. And they behave differently also from epidemiology, pathology, and outcomes which we still don't fully understand. There has been also very slow introduction of innovations. Since the discovery of the bacillus, of the microbe, which was in fact the first microbe to be discovered linking it to a human disease, because we have the before one, you know, but it was also coming from the animals. So in fact of being the first one, Really, for a long time, even during this discovery, and reviewing all the papers, particularly from Daniel Sen, who happened to be the father-in-law of Hansen, he insisted and was a very influential voice in insisting that the disease was hereditary. So you can see that even with the evidence, in leprosy, everything is slow, like this bacillus itself, no? And it was only 100 years after that that it was able to be replicated in footpath mice and later on in armadillo, as was mentioned. Drug treatments were extremely diverse since ancient times, India, China, you can trace, until the apparition of antibiotics. All of them were tested after, until we got the Dapsone, but again, very soon, in less than 15 years, some resistance were already observed. And it took almost 20 years to have multi-drug therapy identified and approved in the WHO guidelines. After the project on the genoma, there has been a lot of, again, mysterious characteristic of these bacillus. It has what the geneticists mention as reductive evolution. It is losing the genes. We don't know if in this adaptative process it will be more difficult or for us to control it, or easier for the bacillus to get to a balance with the host, which will make things even more difficult. And of course, the attempts to develop vaccines, and particularly the use of the adapted BCG, the discovery and developed by Dr. Combit in Venezuela. So with these things, there was a global strategy, finally, the first time that elimination was thought as a possible goal for WHO, with a goal set for 2000. At that time, there were very few highest prevalence countries. The 15 countries where all the efforts were concentrated. And the progress, as you can see in this slide, was amazing. So when really the political will, with the public health knowledge and information, was put in march, was really put to work, things started for the first time in the history of leprosy to change, and very rapidly. And this was mainly due to the registry, something, you know, that was first established in Norway, again, more than 100 years ago. But countries established, some of them, you know, only in the late 20th century. Intensive search, campaigns, the expansion of treatment, and a very close patient's follow-up, including the participation of the communities, the families, and the patients themselves. In the last report that we have for 2014, really the trend is continues to decline. Many countries have achieved the goal of elimination at national level, and now most of the countries have moved to achieve this goal at local level, because as the progress has been made, more and more the disease is being staying in very concrete territories. That has been also the case in Brazil that Rosa will show us later. Just an example in the U.S., so that you know that leprosy is in every country. It has, in the last report to WHO, very few cases, new cases. But again, you can see that the trend and the epidemiology shows that it's being concentrated. In the case of the U.S., it's particularly in males, in white males, non-Hispanic whites, and in only seven states, and within those seven states, is further on concentrated in some municipalities or districts. So the surveillance and critical analysis of the data that we register and look carefully, and also working with the patients, with the families, and the health workers, is essential, particularly because as any disease, when it disappears from the general view, it becomes non-detected because we rely totally in two major actors, the patients, the health workers. And if they don't think about the disease, these diseases, we will be never able to detect it. Unless we develop some new innovations that Rosalia will show. Have worked is an innovation introduced in Brazil using the general public and the school children so that we can raise awareness again. So the looking at imbalance, you know, about the what was achieved by 2000, the WHO issued a new strategy, 2016-2020, which is called the final push. And this is built on around three major pillars. One, of course, is achieving this political will, this government responsibility and awareness that what they have to do and what they have to implement, and don't slow down in your efforts. The second is to stop leprosy and its complications, and stop discrimination and promote inclusion. So now there are more stringent indicators, particularly new cases in children and disabilities in children. So these are more sensitive indicators to show the progress. And again, still in the world, there are legislations and also stigma and discrimination around this disease. So the message of the strategy is focus and focus. So, you know, go with the zoom in terms of understanding much better and being closer to the endemic areas where the patients can be detected. So we can summarize the three major areas of legacy that I mentioned at the beginning, where leprosy is legacy can be benefit the public health work. The first one is about the role of stigma and discrimination, and the focus on human rights and ethical and ethics. This has created a major change in the approach of leprosy control, but it has been applied to many other diseases. The second area is the health system failure. We can understand from the history of leprosy all the things that went wrong from the health system perspective. And then the need for critical investment in research and development. This is just to quote, you know, a very good phrase from Mother Teresa. No disease has caused more pain, disability, and prejudice, not even AIDS. So on stigma and discrimination and legislation, we have to look back at some of the key moments in this process. Of course, you can go back, you know, to some of the writings in the newspaper, major newspaper like the Times, you know, in the 1800s, end of the 1800s. The danger is in the leper. As I mentioned, you know, the first attempt to really understand what was leper instead of condemning it and the patient, in Norway with the first patient registry. But we have to know also what things happened after that, you know, like there was sexual segregation, the patients were not allowed to have children, we have sterilization of leprosy patients, anything that you can imagine has happened in leprosy. In spite of the Royal College of Physicians report, quite a review in 1867, that there were no reason for isolation, the first International Leprosy Congress that was called in Berlin in 1897 called for segregation. And this is what we also link to the failure of the health system and the role of the experts or the specialists in leprosy. Because all the congresses after that, all the International Leprosy Congress until 1920, were recommending segregation. And that's why the leprosarians were established in all the countries like Eugenie mentioned in Brazil. That's why they were started to open. Because the previous leprosarian, and were not really at those Middle Ages and all the things that we know, were not really for leprosy. They were for everything. For blind people, for mental health, for abandoned children, for whatever. This was a charitable approach. It was not really an isolationist approach. But really, it was our own profession that created this thing, in spite of the report from the Royal College. And there has also been a contribution, even in 1875, by Kaposi, who reviewed that many things that were called leprosy were not leprosy. And so also there was an approach, you know, to clarify exactly what we were talking about. And this thing continued. But the thing started to change, particularly after the treatment was discovered. And of course with the WHO working groups and expert groups. But we have to recognize also the role of some key defenders from a human rights approach, like the Special Goodwill Ambassador Sasakawa, and his endorsement and his personal advocacy to get a resolution from the Human Rights Council on elimination of discrimination against people affected by leprosy and their family, which finally moved to principles and guidelines and a UN resolution. I also like to bring this reflection from the famous writer Susan Sontag on the metaphoric use of illness, because I think that this was one of the reasons why Brazil decided in the 90s to change the name of the disease. And that is when you have, you know, a symbolic use of some of these diseases to discriminate, to stigmatize people. So this is also one of the uses of leprosy that is one of the legacies that we have learned. And in terms of the health system failure, as I say, we have been in the medical establishment, and particularly in the specialist domain, those who experts in leprosy, responsible for some of these things, like isolation, like a work of charity and not a public responsibility. A reactive way of treating the patients, but not moving forward to prevent infection or to prevent disabilities. As it was mentioned yesterday, one of the role of ethic, which is balancing the public good with personal liberty. The lack of integration with the primary level, so, you know, bringing it always to under the sphere of specialists and experts, and some of the darkest pages in the history, using the all, which is shared, you know, with all populations that are institutionalized, using the patients for experimental studies. And I think that this is shared not only with the leprosarium, but also with prisoners, mental health institutions, and so on, that have been subject, unfortunately, during history of experimental studies. Finally, in research and development, for many years, the TDR was the only source of funding, plus other foundations like, you know, Father Damian or Sasakawa Nippon, who was the first one to fund the free distribution of drugs until Novartis pick up, you know, this bill. But there have been no incentives really for the search of new diagnostic tests and a poor understanding of the related health determinants, very little research and funding available for that. Major gaps in the molecular biology and pathogenesis is not a main topic in these larger centers of the world. And one thing that is much needed now is more development on chemoprophylaxis and immunoprophylaxis to prevent leprosy, and the understanding of the nerve function, the neurological processes for prevention of disabilities, and more innovative tools that Rosa will show us an example for case detection and treatment. So I think that in conclusion, we can say that one of the things that we, some of us who have worked a long time in public health on leprosy, carry to the world for new things. One was that at the beginning of AIDS, those who have worked with the leprosy were very familiar with the language that was used. And we had a responsibility to tell them about not to do the same mistakes. And first of all is the fear of the unknown. Leprosy was for thousands of years not very well known at all in terms of the disease mechanisms. Also because leprosy is related to the aesthetics. It's a disease that causes deformations and disabilities. And so it is also something that we have helped the people who work in genetic disorders, in congenital disorders, and so on, to how to overcome these things after the experience of leprosy. The other thing is the unclear etiology, slow processes, low uptake of treatment, and all the problems that go with isolation and separation from the society that we have contributed to the new approaches to mental health. The power of legislation and how can we benefit from the instruments of using ethics and human rights, upholding of the principles of human rights to change legislation in the countries. The role of the medical establishment, particularly this charity approach, but also to let some of these diseases be the role of specialists. Again, you know, we contributed to that, to the AIDS epidemics. And also now that the diseases are being reduced in their prevalence, the danger of ignorance and keeping them out of sight so that we forget that they exist and we stop identifying the patient when it is a very low disease burden. And also the final reflection is there is no market for the development of new tools for neglected diseases. Those that are affected are not the highest consumers in the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rose, for this excellent presentation. Our third speaker is Dr. Rosa Castalia. She's a physician trained in the Escuela Bayana de Medicina y Salud Pública. And she has been working on leprosy and Hanseniasis for a number of years. I understand that now she's in charge of the National Program of Control of Hanseniasis in the Ministry of Health. And is a member of a series of committees and organizations, some of them part of the expert committee of the World Health Organization. She's also not only a very distinguished public health officer, but a scholar in the field with publications in international and national journals such as The Lancet, the British Medical Journal, and the Journal of Infectious Diseases. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for the great honor to be here, join two distinguished professors of the two ladies of public health were most very well, most well known worldwide, Dr. Zanier and Dr. Mita Rose. It's a great honor to stay here with them and with all of you. And I will try briefly to show, it's not maybe not a so historical aspect of leprosy as it is the main subject of this seminar, but I will try to show you some integrated approaches in leprosy and some recent and innovative practices in Brazil in order to achieve the elimination as a public health problem goal in the national level and the subnational level too. Okay. So it's just an outline. We are going to talk about Brazilian integrated plan to face NTDs, the general aspects and the link with Brazil without poverty plan, the current epidemiological situation, the combined campaign, and another support, some support activities like the innovative activities, e-learning, leprosy in primary care, and the World Leprosy Day campaign. In 2012, the Minister of Health decided to integrate and to put under the same coordinator in the same direction the leprosy and the other NTDs programs. And this plan, and we launched a plan of integrated activities, strategic actions, and these strategies were based on, first of all, in the resolution CD49 of Pan-American Health Organization, under the leadership that under the leadership of Dr. Mita Rose here, signed all the countries, the endemic countries signed the eradication, the resolution to eradication of neglected disease and other infections that related to poverty. This was the main document that guide, that it was the guidelines, the first guidelines for our plan. And the plan was also based on active search for cases and timely treatment. And the new thing of the new element of this plan was the use of preventive chemoprophylactic interventions when indicated. And the less important aspect of this plan was the integrated approach. I'll try to explain. Because we were putting together diseases that we have that were under PCT strategies, that means preventive chemotherapy strategy, and also disease like intensive disease management case, that intensive disease management. That are the group of disease that we don't use mass drug administration strategy, but individual management for the cases. So the new of this plan was to putting in the same strategy these two groups of diseases. Leprosy is in the second group, and for example, the soil transmitted helminths and schisto and trachoma are in the first one on PCT. So this integrated plan is currently under revision, and the new version will be launched, will be published this year. And in this revision, we are trying to follow the new recommendations of WHO, like, for example, the elimination goal for schisto, also the global strategy for leprosy, the new global strategy that Dr. Mirta mentioned is being considered for this review, And we are doing a review, a big review about the strategies recommended by WHO and the new tools available, like new tests or new drugs, new treatments. And we are going to submit this first draft to all our partners, the community, the scientific community, and state level managers, health workers, in order to adjust it and to update this plan for the next 4 years. And the other thing that we took in consideration for this plan was the Brazil Without Poverty Plan. Those are from Brazil knows very well that the federal government launched a plan in order to reduce poverty, in the poorest areas of the country, and one of the principles of this plan was to increase income security for the immediate reduction of extreme poverty, improving access to public health services, to public services like education, health, and living conditions, and productive inclusion in order to increase capacity and employment of opportunities and income generation for the poorest families. As you could see in the speech of Dr. Mirta, these diseases in the group of the diseases that are poverty related. So we took in consideration, and it was not a surprise for us when we overlap the map of poverty and the map of the disease, and they are in the same place. The neglected tropical disease, leprosy, and the poverty, they are in the same areas. We did this for choosing the priority areas or priority municipalities for this plan. And now going directly to leprosy, I think this is a very interesting frame because it shows the evolution of new detection rate of leprosy from 1985 to 2015, and what are the main events that impacted directly in the decreasing of the new case detection and the controlling the transmission of leprosy. So in this first, here in the beginning when we had the monotherapy treatment, and we had the cases were increasing because they are accumulating. And here, when we have, in this point, around in the 90s, and at the end of the 90s, when we had the primary family health program that could give us the opportunity of increasing the coverage of services, increasing the offer of treatment and of diagnostic and treatment, of course. And what we can see that from the family health program until now, the trend is of decreasing, and it decreased dramatically, in fact. And besides this, we had the information system that allowed us to monitor and also to monitor the and to go straight where the problem were. And now we have an overall of detection rate of leprosy by municipality in Brazil, updated for 2015. And the general detection rate of leprosy in Brazil in 2015, it was 13.8 new cases per 100,000 inhabitants, distributed in 54 percent of the municipalities of the country. More than half of the municipalities of our country register at least one case of leprosy, from 1 to 100 in others. And leprosy detection rate in the population under 15 in children rate in Brazil, it's a little less, of course, as it may be. And we have 4.3 new cases in children in Brazil in 2015 per 100,000 inhabitants. But only 12% of the municipalities in the country reported at least one case of children with leprosy. And children is a very, very sensitive indicator, because it means that we are having active transmission chain. When we have children with the disease, it means that we have active transmission chain in this place. And now, the overall detection rate of leprosy in Brazil by states. For who are not here from Brazil, I'd like to explain that Brazil is a country that we have many differences between the regions. And we have very poor places and rich places, different climates, and etc. And so we have here in Brazil, the new case detection, the new case detection rate is 13 per 100,000 inhabitants, and we have. Since Rio Grande do Sul state with 1.06 until Mato Grosso with 92.64. So as you can see, we have a big difference between the regions. These are the most important high endemic regions, high endemic states. And here we have all the states that had achieved elimination as a public health problem, and you will see the prevalence rates that they are always all of them are with less than one case per 10,000. And the total number of new cases in 2015 was 28,353. And this is a lot, of course. But what's interesting is that last year, 2014, we had around 30,000 cases. And 2013, we have around 30,000 cases. What it means that despite we are improving the strategies for active search and searching for new cases, despite of these strategies, the total number of cases are decreasing, is decreasing, that it means that we are treating more, curing more, and maybe promoting the decreasing of the rates. Overall detection rates in children, as we can see, between 2003 to 2015, we can register a decrease of around 45% in the detection of new of children. This is a very important indicator. And detection rate of new cases of leprosy under by state, if you go by state, we see that the same high endemic state registers also much more cases in children. Regarding the prevalence, that it's the indicator that we use to measure, to define the elimination as a public health problem. In Brazil, we had an evolution, as Professor Elzeni showed, as historical series, that comparing as this one, the prevalence rates with the prevalence rate with the detection rate, but here we have prevalence rates and they're reducing during the years. For 2015, we are very close to elimination goal with 1.15, but we suspected that we can have less than this because many patients that are cured are not registered in the information system. And what we are doing now in this moment with PAHO, we asked PAHO to lead a commission, internal commission, to evaluate our data. And we are going state by state, municipality by municipality, looking for who are the patients that completed treatment but are still in the information system as a patient under treatment. And so we suspect that this number can be lower than that. So we have the reduction in our, of 74% of prevalence rate during 2003-2015. And 2015, 1.15 cases per 10,000 inhabitants, that corresponds to 23.4 cases in treatment in December of 2015. And prevalence coefficient by states in Brazil, and it's differently from the other graphs that I showed you. We have 11 states that 11 states until here that achieved the elimination as a public health problem, less than 1 per 10,000, and we have a lot of them higher than the average of the country. And once again, Mato Grosso comes here with the highest rate of prevalence in the country, like 85 more than the country level. And now the number of new cases of leprosy in children with grade 2 of disability. This is the first time that we evaluate this in Brazil because we are evaluating, we are taking a lot of attention of this indicator in order to, because Brazil signed the Bangkok letter in 2014, that it was a commitment of 17 countries in order to work for decrease the total number of disabilities. And so we have now the average in this from 2001-2015, we have an average of 70 cases by year with a maximum of 80 cases and minimum of 49 cases. And what we can see, what's very exciting for us, is to know, to see here that the effect of the campaign and decreasing of the number of children with leprosy. Despite we're searching more, we are finding less. And here is the percentage of assessed on the degree of disability at diagnosis. This is still a problem for us because it's very difficult to have the professional able to do the able to do the The evaluation of the degree of disabilities in the basic health care attention level. So we had in the last year, the last 3 years or last 4 years, around 80% of patients that they have their degree of disabilities evaluated at the moment of the diagnostic. But the most important is this line that shows what's the percentage among them has a degree 2 of disabilities, that it's an indicator of later diagnostic. It's very important for us to know, and this is we are concerned about this because this is an indicator which is being maintained along during the years. Grade 1 and 2 percentage of disability among the new cases evaluated in the diagnostics in Brazil. And one thing that we have to explain is that 2007, following a recommendation of WHO, we had a change in the classification of the disabilities, and the grade one and grade two were together here. That's because we see we have, but it's an artificial. It's artificial. It's due the sum of grade one with grade two of disabilities, and it's very important for the subject of this seminar, because we all know that the disabilities were responsible for the stigma and for the discrimination of people affected by leprosy. And so to face the stigma and discrimination and change this history, we must invest on preventing and correcting disabilities. The cure rate in cohorts of new cases of leprosy are around 83%. In 2012, we have 88. And this is an agreement we have with the municipalities. It's that we have to find until 20. To go, all the municipalities have to go to 89 at least percent. But one thing that it's very important to point in this here, that Dr. Mitter, differently from the other countries consider that, you know about another countries, consider that when the patient finishes the treatment, it's cured. It's a process of cure. But here in Brazil, no. Here in Brazil, the patients have to be checked by a doctor, and the cure, and to evaluate if they need more, to have another round of treatment, etc. That's the difference, because we use cure rates and not a process of cure rate. And the percentage of contacts examined, in the last year we have an increase, a very considerable increase of the contacts between the case of leprosy being examined. And this is a very important action of health surveillance, of leprosy surveillance, epidemiological surveillance, because as Professor Elzeny published many times, among the contacts is the chance, the possibility of having new cases higher than in the general population. So we are investing a lot on examining the contacts. And in the last 4 years, we did a lot. This work was increased because of the campaign that I will show. Other indicators like by sex, men and women here, and by age group also. We are preparing these indicators in others, these indicators and other variables, because the new strategy, WHO strategy, will introduce some new indicators. So we are doing these exercises in order to start working on these groups. On these groups also, lepers by race, color, also in Brazil. Black people are much more affected than white people, and then indigenous people and Asiatic. Percentage of new cases of lepers by literacy, by the illiterate people here, Brazil, and the fundamental level of education. And to finish, I'd like to show the National Campaign for Leprosy, Soil-Transmitted Helminths and Trachoma. The target audience or the target population were students of from 5 to 14 in public health, in public schools, municipal and state level, for the elementary level. And the goal is to reduce the parasitic load, the parasitic burden of soil-transmitted helminths, to identify suspected cases of leprosy through the MIRO method, and to identify and treat cases of trachoma. In 2013, when we launched this strategy and we invited the municipalities to participate, and it's a strategy by adhesion, and so we had 291 cases of leprosy, almost 3 million of students treated for worms, and 2,300 cases of trachoma identified and treated. In the year 2014, we had 354 cases of leprosy, almost 5 million of students treated, and 10 times more the case of trachoma. In 2013, we had around 800 municipalities doing. In 2014, 2,000 municipalities and 200 doing. In 2015, we had around 2,400 municipalities working on. And we had 272 cases of leprosy, more than 5.5 million of students treated with worms, and a little bit less of cases of trachoma than the previous year. And I would like to take that your attention for the number of cases and the number of trachoma. That means that we increased the area of searching, but the number was decreasing because they are being treated and the transmission was being impacted. And for 2016, we have almost 3,000 municipalities that they want to do this, the expansion of the campaign. And innovative, in order to support this campaign, we launched the innovative actions, and in 14 states, 40 municipalities for leprosy and 3 municipalities for schistosomiasis. And it was the proposed actions is in order to complement the campaign, was active search house by house, hours and days alternatives like the health center opened until the night, until 9 p.m., or house by house in weekends, and examination of household contacts and neighborhood of diagnostic cases of leprosy in the last 3 or 5 years, and parasitological examinations, treatment of positive cases of for schistosomiasis. And as a result, we have 1,400 new cases of leprosy diagnosed on this, and 151 of them were children under 15, and more than 400 were diagnosed among contacts. So we had around 250,000.3 households were visited. A lot of people, almost 700,000 people examined, and the suspected were referred to health facility to confirm diagnostic, and registered contacts were examined. So this was a complementary activity for the campaign. And this is important to know the number of house visited by state, the number of people examined by state of this, and the number of new cases diagnostics by also by state in Brazil. This was a very well succeeded strategy that is the municipalities are requesting us to repeat and to increase, and to much more municipalities wants to do this. And now the other measure for supporting the program that we are taking, the most important, that we have two or three very important. One is the Brazilian Chemoprophylaxis Project for contacts. The strategies will allow us to expand the household contact tests coverage, neighborhood, social or community territorial areas of high risk of transmission of leprosy. The pilot project is in this moment had started in the field in 17 municipalities in the states of Tocantins, Mato Grosso, and Pernambuco. And the goal is to promote the protection of contacts of cases diagnosed by administrating rifampicin single doses, and to evaluate the effectiveness and operation of post-exposure prophylaxis for leprosy contacts. This is a study that many countries are doing. Indonesia is, I think, that's the most advanced. And recently, I heard from my colleague who is working with me in this project that Fiocruz also, Dr. Zeni, is doing also a project of chemoprophylaxis, and in this sense. And so the idea is to expand this as much as we can. And it's officially allowed by the CONITEC in Brazil, is the Commission for New Technologies and the Health Systems. And the other measure, the other activity of support was the e-learning course, Leprosy in Primary Care, that the most deals with STEM, surveillance, diagnostic, and monitoring of leprosy. Use interactive clinical cases, video classes. It's 45 hours. And we have a huge number of people, of subscribers in Brazil. Registration will be open until May, and it's to target doctors, nurses, and other health professionals who are in the field, and it's a very good methodology, and has been very very well accepted by everybody. And Pajo also asked us to translate to Spanish and English in order to spread this course. And I think that, of course, that the doctors and nurses and other professionals will need the practice to be able to diagnose, but this is a very good starting point. Now, in the program of the government, more doctors, the agreement of Brazilian government with PAHO to bring some doctors from other countries, we are using this e-learning course in order to train these doctors, especially those one who are going to the high endemic area. The work day against leprosy that we do in January every year, and we have also the stroke, the house stroke, that it's a partnership with Novartis and Novartis Foundation and Brazilian Society of Leprosy, that it's used in the World Leprosy Day. We have also the update guidelines for surveillance, attention, and attention leprosy as a public health problem, that it was launched this year, and it has the participation of many professionals and researchers, especially of the Brazilian Society of Dermatology and Brazilian Society of Leprosy. And these are some photos of the campaign to show that this campaign does not only search for leprosy cases, but it increases the level of knowledge about leprosy and the other disease, the means to prevent this disease, what to do. So it's also an education project, an education activity. And this is the mobilization, the mobilization in the municipalities with health and education professionals together in community to make this possible. They used a lot of tools like clowns and etc. in order to attract the children. And the partners of all this work is the municipality state health secretaries, the National Council of Municipal Health Secretaries, CONASEMS, that it's very important in order to mobilize the municipalities, PAHO and WHO, ILAP, SABE Institute, Novartis Foundation, Vale Foundation, Brazilian Society of Dermatology and Leprosy, the reference centers and university, Pastoral da Criança, social movement. This is our objective is to involve as much as possible many sectors of the civil society in order to spread the issues of education, the knowledge about diagnostic prevention and what to do. And now to finish, I would like to show you. This is, we are showing during the years how the leprosy map is changing in Brazil. The region is the same, but the disease is being more and more focused in a smaller area. That's what I'd like to say to you. I am at your disposal for any questions. And thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Rosa. Before we move to the questions, I just want to mention that shortly after the questions, we will launch this fantastic book on leprosy that is a bilingual version, right? Among the editors are Magali Romero and Sanjoy. And an important reason to stay here is that they will tell us how to get a free copy by the internet or maybe in print. So if somebody has questions or comments, I would like to provoke the historians. Well, Juliana, want to?
Thanks for the conference. It was very informative. And I think it's my question is for you three. So I think it's no, you can answer to me. Is there any study to compare these municipalities in Brazil to detect any common characteristics? Okay. Is there any study of comparison between among these municipalities with high rates of leprosy and to identify any common characteristics of the persons affected?
No, I know, maybe Dr. Rosa can answer, but I think that maybe you can look for the history of each municipality, the history of the program of each municipality, because there is no difference of genetic difference that could explain. The only, in my point of view, the only explanation would be how the program, how the surveillance, how this recommendation, this program worked to explain, in my point of view.
And one of the things that we observed was the access to diagnostic and treatment was a very, it was like, makes a difference. Because there is no genetics or other scientific difference, but the differences that we observe in our routine of work is the capacity of the municipality on diagnosing and treating patients. Because you can see, in the map I showed, you can see that there are some municipalities with high endemic level, a lot of patients, and one municipality without any reporting any case that are very close to them. That nothing can explain that you can find the neighboring not in this. The only explanation is that this municipality is not able to diagnose and to treat, and probably they have patients that are not a diagnostic. We call them the silent municipalities. And for these silent municipalities, when we have an observatory, internal observatory, to identify these silent areas and go to CONASEMS, is the National Council for Health Secretaries, and say, please mobilize your health secretary because something wrong is happening here. Because this municipality is in a very poor area, all the others around it has reported case of leprosy, and this municipality is silent. So this is a way to mobilize and to correct this. But the factors, in terms of factors, the only explanation, the stronger explanation we have is regarding the structure, the capacity built for diagnostic and treatment.
Well, it's kind of related to the last question, and it's this question of geography and leprosy, because it seems not only in Brazil, but throughout the world, leprosy is in certain areas, and historically almost, why is leprosy in Norway and not in other European countries? And even, similar as in Brazil, similar places, the same geography, the same conditions, don't have leprosy, and some have leprosy. So this connection between geography and leprosy, is there some explanation as to why it's such a geographical disease? Even in Africa, you have some countries or some places, or even within countries, you have places that have leprosy, always have leprosy, and places nearby that don't have leprosy. Is there any explanation for this?
This is a mysterious disease, as I said, It is that's why I put the slide on complex epidemiology. We still don't understand very well, what is the natural history of leprosy in the population, in the human population. But also the evolution in certain areas. There are many even theories, you know. At the beginning, there was a lot of review here in the Americas regarding the fact that the leprosy has been brought by the slaves, but it was not really that, because it was already in Europe, and, you know, so the story changed, that it was, of course, came already with the colonizers, and then, of course, increased during the trade slave. And it, what we know is that looking at the case registration, because you have no other data, you know, specific campaigns and registry are the major sources. And you have two situations. One are the some of the endemic areas where there have always been high prevalence, and in each country you have some of them linked with a certain, I would say, geographical climate characteristics like tropical or subtropical. But of course, you had, you know, as we show, Norway was a country that developed a lot in the science, and Norway is not precisely a tropical country, and so they used to be one of the countries of concentration in Europe. But I think that they detected it, and not necessarily were the highest prevalence. So we have in the region, in the Americas, and in the world, two situations. One are these endemic countries, and within the countries, endemic areas, but then you have migration, internal and external migration. But internal migration has been very important. And most of the times, the other high prevalence areas are the areas of concentration of migration, internal migration, like big capitals, peri-urban areas where the poor live, you know, in big cities. So this is the second, the two areas where we have a leprosy concentrating. Now, leprosy takes a long time of evolution in the patient for manifestations also. And so you also need to understand, you know, the movement and the activities of the people and the levels of, as I showed, the attack rate is very low, even in household contacts. And there have been very few studies, but very low attack rate in workers, like, you know, contacts in the workplace and so on. This is not a disease that is easily transmitted in that area. And so there's no real clear explanation about the how the disease was, you know, finally took this distribution that we are seeing. The thing is that it's easier to detect the patients in the urban areas because they have greater contact with the health services and so on. But on the other side, you have less awareness of the health workers in urban areas to detect leprosy. And so there's also always this balance between the endemic areas and the areas of destination of the migrants.
Can I compliment? Just one view, one point, is that now we have, we are hopeful that some of these questions can be answered, because we have two lines of research that maybe can give us some answer. One is regarding the reservoirs, the reservoirs. And we have the armadillos, we have which animals more. And so, as you know, the animals and are specific of some regions, so maybe we have some. And the other line of research that is being developed mainly in India, but also here in Brazil, I know a study in Mato Grosso, is the presence of the Mycobacterium leprae in good conditions of infection in the environmental, like water, like the soil, and including there is a very good study in of a researcher, a very young researcher in Mato Grosso, that he collected samples of soil in the houses, in the entrance of the houses of people in certain communities. And it was found the Mycobacterium leprae in conditions of infecting. So I think that we have a lot of questions regarding, we have some explanation regarding migrations process, regarding conditions of life in general, and we know it is they are factors, key factors for having, for the maintenance of high level of leprosy, like conditions of life mainly, and education, and conditions of living, because many people together in small houses, of course, it promotes the transmission much more than people living in better conditions of living. But also these factors that the science now is trying to clarify this point, to clarify for us. And I think that when we have some scientific evidence of the viability of the bacillus in the soil, in the water, and we have the evidence, scientific evidence about the importance of the natural reservoirs for the bacillus, I think that we will find a lot of questions regarding the geographical distribution also.
Maybe, oh, Homer, I'd like to tell you an example from Brazil. From the history, there is a thesis about the history of leprosy in the Amazon region. And I don't remember exactly when, but there was no leprosy in the Amazon region until middle of the 18th century. I don't remember exactly. And it started with the rubber extraction that made migration from the northeast of Brazil. And many other areas come to this area. And this was the first document I have heard about this history of leprosy in Amazon region. It is a thesis submitted it with the ANSP. Very interesting. Say that how this migration make this the distribution in Brazil. And in Amazon particularly, there were no leprosy until difference of the other areas colonizers by the, that's it, in Brazil. This is very interesting to answer this question. If you have to go more deep in this past to understand this present, in my point of view.
So, first of all, thank you, Dr. Ilzener, Dr. Mita, and Dr. Hausa for those excellent presentations. It's a very nice and important discussion that we have here. And we are moving, I guess we are now trying to reach a level where we could maybe push towards elimination, towards the zero diagnosis and children, and maybe preventing nerve damage and incapacities. And but one thing that maybe just trying to compare the presentation from Elsener and Rosa, in our reference center here in Rio, we are diagnosing around 8% of the contacts with leprosy. And when we see the innovation approaches that the Minister of Health is funding, actually when we are visiting the households, we are detecting 29% of the contacts, which means that we missed those contacts because they were not actually being evaluated in the primary care, which means that we need chemoprophylaxis and immunoprophylaxis and a more bold approach in a matter of actually, you know, eliminate the disease. Maybe to do that, we should include a diagnostic test,
which is not very easy to do, because we understand that leprosy, it's a very difficult chronic disease, slow progression, and the clinical forms are quite different. So it's not an easy disease to diagnose. But the point is that, if we move towards, contact surveillance, actually I think that we could eliminate the disease. And so it's a matter maybe just to expand the chemoprophylactics, and I think that here in Brazil we're already doing a very good job vaccinating contacts with BCG. And so just maybe having one diagnostic test along with chemoprophylactics and follow-up of those contacts to see why they're actually developing the disease and why they're not developing the disease. So we could maybe in the near future understand a little better transmission. Because obviously when we go to low endemic stage, and I believe that we will do that in the near future, that will be even more difficult to diagnose and handle the disease, which means that maybe we're gonna have what we have in the south of the country. We have low number of cases, but mainly mold bacillary and associated with incapacity diagnosis. So this is one of the things that we actually have to be very careful and plan for the future. Comments, please.
Thank you very much, Dr. Milton, for your observations. We discussed this in the first beginning of this meeting, because that's what we are seeing in many places, that the diagnosis is becoming really much more difficult when the number of cases decreasing, because those that are not being diagnosed now are the difficult cases that will need to go to a referral center, etc. But we have to, regarding the reality of our country, maybe it explains the difference of data between the national data and Dr. Rosini data, is the qualification of the professionals to do the diagnostic. Of course, that the professionals of a reference center are much more able to do the diagnostic of the most difficult cases than the professional of the basic care attention level, because these professionals are not specialized. They are professionals that are able to do everything in general. So if we have a group of high specialized professionals, of course, this group will find much more. That's why one of our concerns in Minister of Health is for the future, for the new future, how to strengthen the referral centers. Because I think that we are going to need, I'm sure that we are going to need the referral centers for many, many years, until speaking about eradication or zero cases. That someday I hope that we can go to eradication, to zero cases. But now we are trying to reduce the burden of the disease and finding the cases that are very simple to diagnostic, that we can do the clinical diagnostic without a basic capacity building of the professionals, and at the same time to prepare our professionals and to prepare the health system to go and to find the most difficult cases. In this sense, we are doing something like this with schistosomiasis, because we are working with the group of researchers of schistosomiasis, because schistosomiasis is reducing a lot still in Brazil, and the areas with lower burden, it's not more possible to work with the tools that we have. So we are working in new tools of diagnosis, including with the Fiocruz team also in order to test like CCA and other tests. And for leprosy, I think that we have to do the same. Have to go forward, moving for new tools, but never forget that leprosy is a clinical disease, and never forget that it's a public health problem, that it's much more for us in Minister of Health, by the point of view of public health, in this moment, we need to have more and more professionals having the basic skills that will allow them to do the diagnostic and to go to refer to the referral centers those cases that they could not confirm the diagnosis. But be sure that the contribution of the referral centers, the trend is that this referral center will increase the contribution for the final push for leprosy elimination.
Before hearing the next question, I'm delighted to tell you that we have our first question by the internet. And it comes all the way from Oslo. So, yeah. My question is probably, is Christoph Gratman, I think it's to pronounce. My question is probably to Dr. Sarno, but it's open to the other two speakers. Thank you very much for your presentation. I wonder if you could say something about how the introduction of sulfone and the subsequent modern therapies played out in relation to stigma. I would also add, what the situation of stigma today. No? And he adds, what is known about the history of leprosy stigma in Brazil after 1940? So, yeah, what happened with stigma and terror?
After the law of sulfone aumentou o estigma, let me see.
Okay, you want to hear the next question and maybe all of you can make your response?
Ele fez outra questão?
No, we have a question from the
audience. I'm going to think about it.
Yeah, okay. Go ahead.
Thank you. First, my name is Albino Belotto. I'm former power staff living in Rio. Congratulate the speakers for the excellent presentations. My curiosity is, because no one mentioned, what is the importance and what is the differential diagnosis between leprosy and vitiligo? Because I realized that in your presentation, the Dermatologist Society of Brazil also is one of the partners of the program. And I wonder if it's important or not, or at least at the very beginning of the disease, both diseases, if they have some similarity or not. Thank you.
I prefer Dr. Elzenir can ask the answer about leprosy and vitiligo.
No. My point would be there is no relationship between these both diseases. But why there is no stigma in vitiligo? Did you ask, was your question? Yeah, because I think that vitiligo is not contagious. Mm-hmm. And everybody knows that leprosy is contagious. This is the first point. I think that one point that stigmatized leprosy patient is the contagiosity of the disease. The second point is disability. The people knows that leprosy, the people, I'm talking about people in general, the leprosy patient are disabled. They lose the fingers, they lose the, they are ugly, they became ugly because of the disease. They have nose, deformities. This also is another point of that makes this maintain, I mean, any stigma that is keep this stigma. While we diagnose patients late with the deformities, we don't stop the stigma. It's not a problem of public health. It's the imaginary of the person that sees someone deformity, ugly, they have stigma. For any other, any disease, and the leprosy is more common disease that do this. So I think that these 2 points, the contagious, and the deformities, the contagiousness of the disease, and the deformities that make the stigma of leprosy present up today, beside all the effort of the society, of the public official, and the everything to stop the stigma. I think that it is what happened.
And another point, can I another point, is that leprosy is the notification is compulsory. So we have a information system that can say us how many cases of leprosy, but vitiligo is not notifiable. So we don't know how the burden of this among us. So it's quite complicated to establish comparison because we don't have the burden of this.
No, my idea was if the beginning, for example, patients go to the dermatologist and they have some stamp in the skin. So I'm talking about the if it can have or not some mistake or misunderstanding on the diagnosis at the very beginning. If not, okay.
Dr. Ross.
Yeah. That was going to be my comment. Vitiligo can be an opportunity for the diagnosis of leprosy. These are two completely different diseases. Mm-hmm. No, but because people are more concerned when they note a change of color in their skin, you know. Unfortunately, in the case of leprosy, the changes in the skin at the beginning are relatively mild.
Yeah.
And the progression is so slow that people don't go to the doctor or to, you know, see a pharmacist or nurse or health center, whatever their level of consultation is. But what we have seen is that if the people are aware and the health providers are aware of searching always for leprosy, vitiligo can be an opportunity because people will move to a consultation with vitiligo very early, because they are concerned about the change of the skin. But there's no relationship other than that, just to take it as an opportunity.
Good morning, my name is Roberta Freitas. I work at Fiocruz Brasilia, the Center of Bioethics and Health Diplomacy. Thank you very much for the conference. And I learned so much today. And I would like to ask how it was the working of with the civil society during the years, and how could we expect the working together with the governments, the academic and the international organizations to work against the last thing that Dr. Rose told us, that the industry doesn't have any interest in of neglected disease. Thank you.
No question.
No one especially, but how it was the civil society movement working during the years, and what we should expect of the working together with governments, academic and international organizations to fight against that the industry is interesting about that this is not a,
a disease that cares about financial.
I think that Dr. Mita is much more able to talk about this, about Dr. Mita.
I think that the what we have presented today, you know, the three of us, is around the same thing, you know, is about having...
Sorry.
Having some of these diseases confined in all the senses of the world. The patients are confined, the specialists who care for these patients are also a small group, you know, so it's all about confinement and keeping these things, you know, like in a separate world. And for thousands of years, then the situation was not changed. Until, of course, and there's a question from the audience, no? I think that when you find a treatment, also because we didn't have treatment, so, you know, you kept all these things there, like in a cupboard. But when the treatment started to be available, there, of course, there was a complete switch, you know, of the attention that this was possible to be, to change and to make a difference. And things started to move in a different discussion. And it became a public, and it became and then a public health concern. And but also, of course, all the changes with the approach of human rights and ethics and legislation and so, and the advances in the understanding of the disease and the public health approach, then I think the next step was to make this a public concern, engaging the families, the patients, the communities, and still we are, as we have said, still we are not there with this disease. Eh? Still there's a lot of question marks, there's a lot of room for research. So I think that the next step, in terms of the strategies of public health, they are clear. But still the missing link is more investment for research and development. Research in understanding the disease, research in the tools for detection, in terms of the tools for preventing and understanding better the nerve damage that is produced in this disease and so on. There's a lot of things that we still don't understand. And the understanding that we have today is enough for taking us to the control of the elimination with the indicators that were mentioned today. But for really preventing that the disease is developed, you know, and infects new people, we are still in a dark age. We need much more investment in research and development in order to make really the final impact on this disease. We will take it to a level of elimination. But that will not say that we are not going to have suffering and new cases and people with disabilities and so on.
And I would like to suggest you to go to the WHO web page, and you will find a document that it's called Investment to Impact NTDs. Mm-hmm. It's excellent. That means this point of view that Dr. Mita said, and the experience of some countries. There are two editions. There are one edition of the end of 2015 that it's quite updated, and you can find all the considerations about what to do to impact the NTDs. And another point is that maybe we have only to invest in development resources, of course, but also in studying the economic impact in the countries of each one of these diseases. Because only if we have the results of economic impact, we can mobilize and the managers, the stakeholders, saying them, or if you, the stakeholder, if you face If you invest on this, if you decrease your number of lepers, for example, we'll have much less people disabilities, much less people requiring the social and the governmental help for living, etc. And so I think that the question, I suggest you, if you like this system, I suggest you to read this document. It's published, it's organized by Dr. Christopher Fitzpatrick. He's an economist in health of WHO, excellent expert on this system. And this report is really very, very interesting to see this aspect.
Thank you very much. I will ask you to bear with us a few more minutes because we're going to move immediately to the launching of this book, Leprosy, A Short History, Lepra, Hanseniasis, Una Breve Historia. And I would like to invite Sanjoy Bhattacharya to join us. And Rosa Castaglia has agreed to say a few words about the book.
Yeah. Oh, it's really a great honor to me to stay here in this global launch of this very, very important book. And firstly, I would like to congratulate the authors and the person of Dr. Sanjoy here that it was really a great initiative. I saw this book around 2 weeks ago in Geneva, the Global Leprosy Team Leader Global Leprosy Program team leader distributed it for us in advance, the launching, and everybody was really very impressed with this. And the thing that I would like to comment is that we have a lot of course, we have some books of history of leprosy, but what is different for me in this? I think that the initiative was great, was really, really great, because we have a very good quality of tests and some very expressive photos of this. And this book is allowing us to have an overview of the leprosy and to make us sure that we cannot separate and look in a separate ways the current moment from the past. There are not two moments in leprosy. There is a moment in leprosy. And regarding the book, I think that the most important thing of this book for us, by the point of view of public health, is in the chapter 4. Leprosy as a reference for the new global public health. I think that leprosy is one very emblematic disease that, as Dr. Rose showed in her presentation, that is until now challenging us and guiding at the same time in public health issues. But I think that many questions that we had, how can the past support or guide the present in the leprosy context, and how can the past say us where to go and how to do, I think that the answers are in this book. And when I saw the format of the book, I confess that I thought, it's another book of photos because of the shape of the book. I said another book of photos of leprous people and the old colonies and etc. Because they are available, of course, but there are many. There are many that can count the story through the photos. But it's not easy to understand the story through photos if you don't know the context. And this book has texts and photos very, very expressive. So, Dr. Magali, I would like to congratulate you very much for leading this initiative.
And I to congratulate all the authors and to recommend or to expect that maybe this book can be available for a higher number of people, because it will help those that are very sensitive about the human question, and also those who are looking for more scientific explanation about the present, about the current situation, why we are here, why, how did we came to this point. So I think that the chapters are very important. It contains an overview of the main regions of the Asia, and also the Latin America and Brazil. And we can see here the difference, how the same disease and did the same damage in so different societies with different cultures, with different ways of life. So I think that we have here in our hands a very important tool to guide us towards our planning of activities, to make us remember every day why it's so important to fight against this disease, why it's so important to prioritize this disease. Personally, I would like to use this book to mobilize the stakeholders, that mobilize my boss, in order to convince them that you must continue applying, investing in applying researches and investing on leprosy. And also to remember everybody that if you don't do this, you will find, will have a lot of human suffering. A lot of human, that's the main point, the human suffering. And to finish, I would like to thank you very much for the photos of Brazil regarding the in page 95. If you go to the chapter of Brazil, you'll find a photo of the campaign, the integrated campaign. And it's very interesting. It's a very interesting series of photos in Brazil, because you have in one page a patient with lion's face, that it's a very severe form, and in the other hand you have, in the other page you have young professionals learning how to do the examinations. You have the campaign. You have the two points that leprosy can show. Leprosy can show an old face of a disease, a millenary disease, and a very old disease, and a very complicated disease, and a new face as integrating with another disease, as doing, working, the children working. And one very important thing of aspect of this work with children is because we're creating maybe a generation of people without any kind of prejudice or discrimination, because they are learning that leprosy is an infectious disease, as well as trachoma is, as well as STH is, as well as schisto is, an infectious disease only. And I hope that in the future, the future generations can look for this book, and not only to see from where they are coming, but to where they are going. I'm really very touched and very happy and honored to be here in this moment, because I think that it must be really a guidebook, not only for professionals, but
that these books always able to integrate health professions, to integrate civil society, all the sectors in the language is so easy to understand. So the professionals, health professionals can take advantage, but also the other sectors of the civil society can read easily, all the other people or the other professionals can read easily and be aware of the importance of this disease for the not only for the human being, for the because of the suffering, but also for the public health development, because it was a very singular disease that has a lot of interfaces with many, many other sectors. And for this, I think that this is a disease that definitely deserves a book like this. And thank you very much for your kind attention. And thank you, Sanchoy and Magali and Ximena here, Dr. Elzeni, for so beautiful and so important tool for the fight against leprosy.
Sanjo, would you like to say some words and close the event?
I'd just like to thank everyone, really, for being here today, making the event so special. I'm delighted to be here. I'm honored to be here. I think the speakers did a magnificent job. I've learned a lot, despite being involved in the production of this book, about the Global Health Program, National Health Program, and leprosy. So I'd like to thank the speakers for contributing, and of course, Professor Sarnoff for contributing to the book as well. It's been a pleasure working with you. Fiocruz, you've been wonderful as ever organizing this. I'm delighted that you have offered your help to extend the Global Health History seminars in the Americas. I'm sure I can't think of better hands for this to happen. I'm very grateful to Dr. Claudia Stein and Dr. Niels Fittier in the WHO Regional Office for Europe, which is now the coordinating center for the Global Health History Seminars. And Claudia has indicated to me that she's very happy to work with all of you in Fiocruz, and let's hope there are many years of collaboration. We continue to work with WHO regional offices around the world, in the countries, and of course departments in headquarters itself. So this is business as usual, but on a global scale. So Human, with whom I worked for 10 years to develop this, we've got to 97 thanks to Human, so thank you to you. But there is one thank you I want to give all of you. It is my linguistically challenged nature that has forced you to hold this event in English, ask questions in English, converse in English, when I'm very aware that, you know, you're more comfortable with the wonderful Portuguese language and indeed Spanish. So I'm delighted that this seminar series has also moved to the Americas, because I think multilingualism in research, in health communication, and public engagement is very important. Sometimes in the academic worlds that are very Anglo-centric, the ones that we sometimes choose to inhabit, we forget the centers of excellence in non-English speaking countries, in non-English speaking contexts. For me, as a historian, I've always been aware of Fiocruz's importance to global public health. Therefore, from a historian's standpoint, I'm delighted that the work in the Americas is being pioneered by a non-English-speaking institution. You speak very good English, but I think the push to multilingualism in research is very important. It's important for equity as well. As a historian, I'm aware of three types of history, if not more: history as propaganda, history as memory, and history as a self-critical tool. I think it's history as a self-critical tool that is useful for policy, because the health problems that we have faced and we continue to face are complex problems. We cannot solve those complex problems with artificial histories that are propaganda or publicity that advertise the role of one or two people or one or two institutions. So understanding history in all its complexities in many languages, the cultural, the social, the political, the economic determinants of health, as historians can uniquely do by having a long-term perspective, is very, very important. And I love the term Dr. Mehta used, you know, fighting containment. I think we have to fight containment. We have to work across disciplines. We have to create bridges. If we are to deliver what we all are so passionate about, that is improving the health of the people who most need our help. So a big thank you to all of you for all the work you've done, and let's hope we can create new bridges, new alliances between historians, social scientists, policymakers, and WHO colleagues. So thank you very, very much, all of you. And Marcos, thank you for chairing today. Thanks. Yes, the copies of the book are outside. Please help yourself. As I speak, we're also making sure that the book will be available open access. When the book becomes open access, we will send you links. It is open access. Okay, wonderful. So I have colleagues, and honestly, without my center colleagues and the publisher's help, this book would have been impossible. It's open access. Feel free to put the link on your personal websites. It's, you know, the more people know about the message, the better. Thank you. And thank you to the Wellcome Trust, the Sasakawa Memorial Health Foundation, and the Nippon Foundation for their support for all these projects. Thank you.